I thought bananas were supposed to help out with potassium deficiencies. Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Mark Batwell at PerfectGardens.com. I'm just kidding, guys. We're going to get into all kinds of great pictures today. Let's go ahead and do it. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. It's always helpful with the YouTube algorithm. Make sure to check out our membership site where I set up a very inexpensive way to get quicker access to me. Just for $2.99, all of your questions get prioritized. Right now, I'm getting over 100 questions a day, and it's difficult to get back to all of you guys. And this is just the easiest way to bring some questions to the surface. Okay, so real quick, let's talk about the benefits of potassium. It aids in the photosynthesis and food formation, helps convert sugars into starches, and stores in the root system for long-term use. That detail is going to be important because I'm going to be showing you pictures and comments from a grow client that went through some of these issues. And right there in the pictures, I'm going to show you these pictures. And just remember the point about how potassium stores its energy in the roots, because that's also going to show up as a plant deficiency or toxicity. Because plants store the energy in the roots, potassium is going to help with root growth. In addition to this, it's going to help with drought tolerance by building cellulose and reducing weak stems. It's going to maintain trigger pressure, which is basically water pressure against the cell walls, and it's going to help reduce water loss and wilting. It improves protein content in plants. Why? Because in water is where the minerals are at. And in my other videos, I talked about what are amino acids, peptides, and proteins. Make sure to check that out. Although by increasing the protein content, you're increasing the organic compounds, which are amino acids, peptides, and proteins. The water system is the blood transportation system for the plant. So that's why potassium actually aids in over 60 other coenzyme reactions. When you have good, clean, healthy water, it's going to help reduce crop disease. By you just having nice, healthy, clean water is a great way to rid yourself of a lot of problems. You have to remember that potassium is a mobile nutrient, so you want to look to the older leaves first to identify your deficiencies or your toxicities. So let's go ahead and get into the pictures now. Okay, so right before we get into the pictures, I've been posting a lot of pictures in the community section in the YouTube. Make sure to go there, because before I post these videos, I'm posting pictures and getting your guys' thought process going through polls and other things I'm posting. So just be aware, just in case any of you guys aren't aware what I'm doing over there. Okay, so once again, I have to blur these pictures out because of the YouTube algorithm, so I'll also be referencing these plants as your tomato plants. Older leaves turn pale and suffer chlorosis. Leaf margin tips turn rusty color and burn. And that's the leaf I actually provided right here. I guarantee you guys, if you look at these pictures, you're going to notice it on your tomato plants. Once you see these leaves, you're going to instantly recognize it, and you're going to be like, oh wow, that's very interesting. And remember, you're going to really see a potassium deficiency, in my viewpoint opinion, earlier in your grow in the vegetative period. And you're going to see a toxicity later in the grow, more as you're already into flowering. Even as me just saying that, right, I'm saying, hey, you're probably going to see the deficiency here versus there. Once you see the picture, you're like, you know what, I saw this. Now I'm going to be able to increase my potassium a little bit more versus having to send my plants out to lab analysis and pay hundreds of dollars for testing that's unnecessary. When you can just do what you have to do, when all you have to do is just recognize what's happening and be aware. Is it a mobile, immobile, or a semi-volatile nutrient? Is it going to appear in the newer leaves? Is it going to appear on the older leaves? And just being aware of the basic nutrients, is you'll at some point be able to develop your language with the plants. Flowering becomes retarded or diminished, and stems often become weak, scrawny, and sometimes brittle. Okay, so let's go ahead and get into the excess. And as you can see right here, I just created some arrows just pointing out very specific parts of the plant that I'm showing you. And again, I could be wrong on this. And if you think I'm wrong, please leave a comment in the section below, because if I will, I'll create another video telling you I was wrong. Anyways, when I point out this excess right here, I come over here and I see newer leaves develop intraveinal chlorosis. And I point it out right here. And if you could just look at the leaves, and you can see that the leaves are starting to turn yellow, the veins, while the center parts are actually still staying green, right? And when we talk about the newer leaves, what are we saying, right? These are newer, and these are older. So when you look further down, you can actually see that these leaves right here are a little bit darker. leaf tips and margins burn. So once again, you're starting to see the leaf tips and the margins burn, right? Causes calcium, magnesium, zinc, and iron deficiencies. And why is that, right? It's because water is the blood transportation system for the plant, and potassium helps out with that process. And so when you have excess or when you have a deficiency, there's a good chance that it's making your other minerals locked out. At the end of the slide, I'll actually talk about two laws. I talk about them all the time, but I'll reference them at the end just keep that in mind, though, as when I reference a deficiency or even a possibly a toxicity, who knows how they appears in the plant. Lower leaves curl and develop spots. So as you can see right here, they develop, and I couldn't really see much spots, but you never know how it's going to appear in the plant. Okay, so another picture right here, just kind of showing you another perspective or angle on the plant. And then once again, an up-close picture of the leaves. You can see the intervening right here. Once again, I'm going to show you another text right here. It said, never doing an auto in the 7-gallon again. The roots didn't come anywhere near the side of the pot. As a matter of fact, it was no bigger than a softball. Right here, root zone is acidified. Root tips die back. And this is what he's describing right here. He is describing potassium excess. At least this is how I see it. And obviously, when I go back, I look at what his nutrient line is using, and like I normally do. I'm not going to get into the specifics all about it. Although, if you checked out some of my past videos, I talk about it all the time. But I did pull them out because he's using Fox Farm. And in Fox Farm, they recommend the Tiger Bloom, the Cha Ching, and the Bembe. So I just pulled out these two, not the Bembe. I couldn't find the label on the internet. And this is what I found, that in all of these chemicals in those bottles, there was actually only three chemicals that I actually approve on. Obviously, I'm not a chemist, but when you look at how these chemicals are derived, these chemicals actually are also created in nature. All these other chemicals right here are not created in nature. You don't find them ever in nature. And in my opinion, this is why the plant's kind of having these deficiencies, right? Because they're having an issue processing these nutrients, because these salts, in my opinion, they'll bind together or they'll fall off solution, or they won't even be water soluble whatsoever. In addition, the sodium borate actually makes your soil alkaline. So again, I don't agree with the formulation. The two laws I always talk about are the law minimum and the law of tolerance. The law minimum states that the growth is not dictated by the total resources available, but by the scarcest resource available. This is a solution. Obviously, you hear me talk about drops balance all the time on the channel, and it's just because there are two main problems in this industry that, if solved, will create huge amounts of solution. The first is the amount of man-made chemicals used either as a pesticide or as a fertilizer or as a fungicide. And drops balance actually will help convert all of these man-made chemicals back over to natural pathway chemical reactions that actually will stimulate microbiology and will go back to feeding the microbes, which is what we want. The second thing and how it's going to benefit you is all of the trace minerals. The next law I always talk about is the law of tolerance. And as you can see the pictures right here, you have the zone of intolerance, you have the tolerance range, and then you have the optimum range. And you could think about this in 100 different ways. I just had a conversation with Chris from Mr. Grow It, where he brought up a number of great perspectives around the optimal range. I highly recommend you check out that video. I believe he also has it on podcast if you don't enjoy the video part. Although the law of tolerance states that the abundance or distribution of an organism can be controlled by certain factors, where in levels of these exceed the maximum or minimum limitations of tolerance of that organism. So as you can see here, if you have too much or if you have too little, it creates environments that are not tolerable for optimal growing conditions. I always like to bring up this slide where you see how all the minerals actually have a relationship with each other, and they're all working together. And these are just a few minerals listed. So that being said, I hope this video was helpful on just kind of seeing firsthand of what a deficiency looks like and an excess looks like, because I think there's not really a lot of good growers out there that can actually feel comfortable just showing someone, hey, this is an excess. excess. This is a deficiency. This is potassium deficiency. This is a nitrogen deficiency. This is a nitrogen excess, because they just haven't had enough firsthand experience looking at plants in many different grow rooms, indoor, outdoor, greenhouse, California, Colorado, and been fortunate enough to have a father and a mother that were in our culture growing every single year. Doesn't matter. My father always had a garden, so I was able to see orchards, tomatoes, leafies, everything you can imagine. He was always taking me to the side and saying, hey, check this out. This is what you add. And thank God it took hold and I actually made it a passion for myself. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and have a great grow, everyone. Monsanto's is owned by Bayer, which is a pharmaceutical company. Okay, calm down, Mark. It doesn't matter that a multinational conglomerate company that has been known for thousands and thousands of lawsuits and the releasing of some of the worst man-made pesticides, if not the worst, this world has ever seen. Although I really have to reserve my emotions whenever I'm doing a product review to the best of my ability.